Hello.
How is it going? Are you part of this cold
It's
snap?
oh my gosh. Yeah, I am simply staring at the, depending on how where the wind has blown it, we have anywhere from 20 centimeters to 40 centimeters of snow out there. And yeah, it's like minus a lot.
Susie's saying down in Atlanta, they're having like -5 Celsius.
Yeah, we're a whole lot colder than
No, I know, I know. And that's the thing,
that.
right? Like Atlanta is sub-zero, which
Yeah.
is crazy. So,
Yeah.
yeah.
I'm now curious what our temperature is.
We're -5 here as well. Celsius, which is, I think, 12 degrees Fahrenheit. Yeah, no, how do you like your global warming?
You know, global warming actually predicts that the temperature extremes are going to get larger and larger, such that you'll have significantly colder weather in the northern and southern latitudes, whereas the equatorial regions get much hotter. So this actually fits global warming models, no matter what all the cranks say.
Yeah, absolutely. It was great. Nancy was actually battling some people on Twitter because people were accusing us of being global warming apologists or socialists or whatever it is. This is weather, right? Like what changes on a daily basis, this is called weather. And
Yes.
the long-term trend, when you measure every spot on Earth all the time, the trend is up.
Yeah.
So
Yeah. So we're minus 34 Celsius wind chill right now.
No, -34.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awful.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, you know what? I have a friend who just flew back from Winnipeg when it was -51.
Yeah, I love the fact that on New Year's it was colder in Winnipeg than it was where Mars Curiosity was.
I know that is
It
so great.
and the other day it was, what was it, Spirit's 10-year anniversary on the Mars. And I remember the day Mars landed, I was working in Boston, and it was warmer where Spirit landed that day in Boston than it was in Boston. It was warmer that day in Mars.
Than in Boston, yeah.
Yeah, order those words the way they need to be ordered.
I did. But no, I mean, on Mars, you can get, in the middle of the day, in the middle of summer, near the equator, you can get 10 degrees,
Yeah.
15 degrees above zero with no atmosphere. So you
Right.
still wouldn't want to walk around, but at least you wouldn't have to wear a coat. You would just have to wear a spacesuit.
Yeah,
So.
it's a oppressor suit. They have an atmosphere. It's just not enough to prevent your skin from like continuously bruising, and it certainly doesn't provide enough oxygen.
No, this weather is something. But we're pretty lucky here on the West Coast. If you look at these maps, the whole continental United States and Canada is just it's all sub-zero,
It's
except for the West
death.
Coast, from California up to us. It's nice. So yeah, it's pretty funny.
Yeah, I got a phone call last night from the barn saying, "Do not even try to come out here."
Yeah, that's
So,
great.
yeah.
All right. So for anyone who like wonders what on earth they've encountered, this is us getting ready to record our live episode of Astronomy Cast. We're going to be doing episode 329, which is Space Telescopes Part the Third, where we talk about amateur space telescopes. So we'll take about 25 minutes to record the episode, and then we'll stick around, and I will permit you to ask questions of Dr. Pamela
I don't
Gay.
think the word permit is correct. He will encourage wrongly.
I will briefly permit. No, permit's the word I like. No, I will encourage. I will, yeah. But yeah, no, it's going to be great. We'll ask your questions, either about the stuff we talk about in the show or just like whatever space madness you want to go into. Pamela can handle it all. The harder the question, the better. Like, really, you should collaborate.
Why do you do this to me? Do you not
Because
like me anymore?
I do. Are you kidding? It's the way I show respect. I demonstrate your awe-inspiring intellectual prowess to a world community. There.
Okay.
You like that? Is that why?
Sure.
All right. Cool. Okay, so now you can interact with us. So you can interact with us on the Q&A app. It's probably the best way to do it. And so we've enabled that. And so it's like at the bottom of the video, it says click to join the live QA on Google Plus Hangouts. If you click that, you get another interface. There will be the questions and the video, and you can interact with us. Now, we're seeing that some people are having some errors. I know there's some problems with YouTube right now. So there is no guarantee that this video will ever get saved and that anybody can even see it. So if you can't see this video right now, please let us know.
Yeah, you can tweet us, tweet me, at StarStrider, leave comments on the event page.
Yeah.
Let us know what's going on.
Yeah.
We're sorry.
See, so I'll show you how the Q&A app works. Judy Rooks Wilder wants to know, what's this in degrees? I am from the old school. So I have no idea what that is in Fahrenheit.
Oh, so we're minus 30 Fahrenheit, minus 34 Celsius.
Okay. All right. Yeah. I am bilingual. As a Canadian, I am bilingual in distances, weights, volumic measurements, not temperature. We have no context of Fahrenheit. If you say it was 70 degrees out, I have no idea what that means.
Yeah, and for the snow, it like varies from just enough to get in the top of your boot to, oh my God, it's approaching my knee, depending on how much the wind has been blowing it.
It just swallowed my car.
Yeah, we haven't. I've seen that. We don't have that.
All right, are you ready to go?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Apologize, I got the hems today.
I have the sniffles. We're going to hurt Preston. We're sorry, Preston. You're not hearing this, Preston, but we're sorry.
You'll hear it in a second. All right, so say when.
I'm just checking that I'm in mono because this is me. Yes, I am. Okay, I am pressing the record button. It is recording.
I have also pressed the record button. Here we go. Astronomy Cast, episode 329, Telescope Making, Part 3, Amateur Space Telescopes. Welcome to Astronomy Cast, our weekly facts-based journey through the cosmos, where we help you understand not only what we know, but how we know what we know. My name is Fraser Kane. I'm the publisher of Universe Today, and with me is Dr. Pamela Gay, a professor at Southern Illinois University, Ebbetsville, and the director of CosmoQuest. Hey, Pamela, how you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you doing, Fraser?
Good, and as we sort of mentioned in the pre-show here, it is bloody cold everywhere across your country and mine.
Yeah, we have wind chills of minus 30 Fahrenheit, which is minus 34 Celsius, and the snow in the drifts is approaching knee-deep and is pretty much everywhere deep enough it's going to go in the top of your boot.
And we mentioned that... On Christmas Day, the temperature in Winnipeg was colder than the temperature on Mars. It got down to
New Year's Day,
to minus 51 Celsius, which is, I'm sure, infinity in Fahrenheit. So I mean, and my friend was in this, and she just said it was incomprehensibly cold.
Like, yeah,
you do not leave the house.
She went out one time. I went to Michigan State University as an undergraduate, the winners of this year's Rose Bowl, I think I'm required to say. And there was a couple of times it got down to minus 40. It was like pretty much every year in February. But then one year it hit minus 70 wind chill, minus 70 Fahrenheit wind chill. And they closed campus. It's like one of the very few times in memory they've closed campus because your eyeballs start to freeze over at that temperature.
Cool. all right, well, let's get rolling. So as we've said before, all telescopes really want to be in space. In part 3 of our series on amateur telescope making, we bring you up to speed on the final frontier, amateurs building space telescopes. The hardware and software is available off the shelf, and launches have never been more affordable. The era of amateur space telescopes has arrived. Now, when you put this topic on the docket, I could not believe my eyeballs, because this is the kind of thing that I would put as the topic. And you would roll your eyes and you would say, no, no, we're not ready for that yet. It's a little premature. Let's wait a couple more years.
It finally became enough years. We've been recording since 2006. And yeah, it's 8 years makes a huge difference. We've gone from watching Spaceship One win the X Prize to now crowdsourcing satellites.
Yeah, and there have been a couple of these now that are coming together. So where do you want to start? Do you want to talk about, let's talk about the various technologies and new companies and the things that have come together, the trends that have really made this affordable and available in just the last couple of years.
Well, so when we say space telescopes, this can mean everything from, there's one called Arcade, which is being put together by Planetary Resources. That's a bona fide space telescope. Think Hubble, a little bit smaller, but all the bells and whistles of a space telescope. But then you also have a lot of basically soda can sized devices that have a variety of open source technologies on them. Most often Arduinos, which are just little circuit chips that are easy to plug into your computer and code, and you're off and running. And they're sending up low cost cameras attached to these Arduinos and basically chucking them off the side of the International Space Telescope.
Yeah, and we've got just like in the last couple of days when we're recording this, they attached the Earth Cam, which is an Earth-facing camera, to the International Space Station, which is going to be broadcasting live views, and it's a steerable camera, and it was done by a private company, and it was launched to the space station and attached onto the space station. So. I think also we've got launches or costs are coming down as well.
Well, it's not so much that the costs are coming down, because that's still not entirely the case, but if you get your spacecraft small enough, you don't have to have the cost of the launch go down, because the launch cost is related directly to how much you weigh. So these little craft are piggybacking along with other satellites that are already on board and paying the bulk of the launch cost. So we've actually seen a couple of different launches. There were four of the Pocket Quebs, or Pocket Cubes, I'm not sure how they're pronouncing this, that launched on one of the Russian Demper rockets in November. SkyCube launched some of theirs also in November. And RduSat launched two of theirs in November, and these different satellites, they're literally about the size of a soda can or smaller.
There was a week where the record number of satellites had been launched in 1 week. It was like 25 satellites in 1 week, and then later that week or the next week, that record got broken by an even larger collection of microsatellites, same kind of deal, right? And so you, as you said, you can with the miniaturization of technology now, you can pack down all of this stuff into this tiny little form factor, and as you said, just stick it into all the nooks and crannies of the launch fairing, and off it goes.
And not all of them can count as space telescopes. I mean, some of these things are getting launched strictly to reflect back amateur radio signals, are getting launched so that you can tweet to space and have space respond. There's lots of different reasons that these things are going into space. There was a project by a Cornell graduate student to launch basically little tiny chips into space. These are the KickSats. But what's kind of awesome is the fact that there are some of these that are being designed so that they can take pictures either of space or of Earth. Either case, you're looking at optics. I'll call that a telescope. And they're accessible to school groups and private corporations.
So talk me through this then. Let's say that I am a wealthy individual. I've already spent a car's worth of money on my wonderful telescope, and I've got this, great big telescope and mount and observatory, and I've still got a little money kicking around in the bank, or a lot of money kicking around in the bank, and I want to take it to the next level. So what's the process then if I want to actually design and launch my own space telescope, my own mission.
You don't even need to design your own. That's the kind of awesome thing, is projects like Pocket Cube, spelled with a Q, so POCKQUBE, which is why it might be pronounced slightly different. I'm not sure. Okay. They have designed a standardized infrastructure that you can use to launch these PICO satellites. They're looking at anywhere from a few hundreds to tens of thousands of dollars per device plus launch cost. And they're hoping to piggyback on other missions. This is one of the ones that they've already launched for. They're looking at a second launch in Q2 of 2014, so sometime after March, before June. And what they're doing is they're saying, we've figured out the technologies that will work. We are telling you, here are the plug-and-play pieces you have. So instead of going to Newegg and ordering the pieces for your desktop computer, you go to Pocket Cube and order the pieces you need for your low-cost satellite. It's a new DIY way of looking at exploring space.
And so for all missions, what are you going to need? You're going to need like a power system. You're going to need a communications system. You're going to need some kind of orientation.
Right, and all of this is designed into what they're doing. So right, you need a way to keep your orbit oriented. So gyroscopes generally are the way they do this. You're going to need a power source, whether it be solar, drag-induced, onboard battery that lasts however long your mission lasts. And then you need the sensors that you want in a way to get commands to the mission and data back from the mission. But it's not all that complex when you start comparing it to what, well, your smartphone can do. And there's actually different groups that have essentially launched the moral equivalent of a smartphone into space. So these are your satellite phones, essentially.
Right. And they're running, I know, like one was just running Android.
They launched
a satellite running Android. Worked like a charm. Yeah.
So when it comes to your bona fide space telescope, what you're going to want to do is probably partner with Planetary Resources. They're a commercial company that's looking to design a whole series of spacecraft. The first one in their Arcade series is a space telescope. And one of the things they did that just about everyone else did too is they raised money through Kickstarter. So they were able to raise $1.5 million. They were only planning to raise $1 million, but they exceeded their goal. And they were actually the first of these projects to get funded. They were funded all the way back in 2012, but they still haven't launched. What they're doing is a lot more complicated, so it's going to take them time.
And I know that the $1.5 million that they raised is not the actual launch cost of the satellite. It's a fraction of it. It's not a fraction. It's a pretty big component of it. I think it's about a third or a quarter. Like, I think the whole mission is going to cost more like $5 or $10 million. But the goal is, I know that their goal is to bring all these costs down. So these are kind of off the shelf. You pick all your pieces, and the cost is more in the $1 million mark or the $100,000 mark.
Right.
Like, they're really going to bring, because at the end of the day, the components, as we said, they're off the shelf, they're miniaturized, the smaller they get, the cheaper they get, and it's really more about hardening these components to the environment of space.
Right.
But you could literally take your smartphone, you could take your iPhone, stick it on a rocket, launch it into space, and it could record video as it tumbled and would have no way to get it back to Earth.
Exactly, and right? Its battery would only last about 24 hours.
Yeah, so these things will work there. So it's just a matter now of making these more of a commodity, and as the prices come down, the companies are coming on board. And Planetary Resources is one. What are some others?
So on the other price extreme, you have the Arjusat people. They did a different Kickstarter. They were looking to raise $35,000. They instead raised $106,000. And for them, that was the entire cost of not just the one they planned, but actually two separate CubeSats. And their goal was to put together a platform that because it's built purely on Arduinos using standardized drivers, standardized technology, school groups, clubs, amateurs, DIY hobbyists, commercial outfits that don't have huge goals can all essentially buy time on their satellites to run their experiments, and they've partnered with NASA to get their launch costs essentially paid for, and they're again working to create a standard open source platform. They launched both of their spacecraft and they've actually been deployed now from the International Space Station, and you can go to their website, and I've linked to all of this off of a post on starstrider.com. You can go to their website and you can actually look to buy slots of time. Right now you have to spend $1,000 minimum. That gives you four separate slots to run experiments. But that's, in the grand scheme of things, $1,000 is something that you can feasibly do as a school group through selling of a monster number of cookies.
Yeah, but I mean, you as a researcher, when you want to get access to telescope time, there is a limited number of telescopes and even a more limited number of space telescopes. And if you're a researcher and you want access to them, you essentially have to write a wonderful proposal and then beg and grovel for telescope time.
Right. And unfortunately, these still aren't suitable for professional researchers. These are still educational tools. So we still have a long ways to go.
Well, you can look at some of the things, like Canada has the MOST telescope,
right,
also known
right.
as the Hubble Space Telescope.
Yes.
And this, I think it was $8 million to build and launch this telescope. And it's been used for gravitational microlensing and
variable stars
and things like that. So if you specialize the capabilities of the telescope and deal with all the miniaturization, I'm sure we're right around the corner from people putting up telescopes for pay telescopes, you know? Someone will put up a telescope where you'll pay your $1,000 for X amount of time on the scope, and then you just put that into your research and you put that into your grant. So instead of both doing your grant and asking for the money, you'll just ask for the money, do your grant and ask for telescope time. You'll do your grant and ask for money, and then use that money to buy telescope time on one of the options.
Yeah, unfortunately for a lot of researchers, our needs are so specific that the instruments, not the telescope, but the instruments are in the tens of millions of dollars case. So I think there we are still another decade out, is especially where NASA has put forward there's going to be no more massive observatories getting launched in the future. So there's going to be people driven to try and figure out how to build the low-cost instrumentation. But while we can get the smaller systems, the soda can-sized systems, down to reasonable costs. The Hubble Space Telescope is fairly small, but it's still the size of a school bus, and that is still out of reach.
Yeah. But I think as well, I mean, the goal with SpaceX is to really, they're not there yet, but the goal is to really bring down those launch costs significantly.
Right. And that's where it's the trade-off between how much the launch costs and how much the telescope costs. Because if you're looking at a few million dollars to a few tens of million dollars for the instrument, you still have to come up with that money somewhere.
Yeah, but I mean, with these CubeSats, you're only looking at a few tens of thousands of dollars for the launch costs to incorporate your satellite within a larger payload, especially with these old ICBMs and stuff. I mean, it's very reasonable.
Right. So it's just a matter of what is your goal. So if I'm trying to do astronomical research, I'm going to want a mirror that's bigger than what will fit in a soda can. And that's where the launch costs are still quite high, and where the instrument costs are still quite high, and the mirror costs are still quite high. But if I want to take basic pictures of the Earth, if I want to take large-scale images of the sky or simple photometry like they do with MOST, those are things that I can start to do small. Mm-hmm. It all depends on your science goals, and unfortunately, most science still requires the school bus sized or larger space telescopes.
Yeah, no, but I mean, when you think about like some of the telescopes that join us for the virtual star party, I mean, we have some people with 14-inch telescopes. I wonder how small a telescope you could make that would give you out in space, what kind of quality would you get? You know, how much smaller, you know, if you launched a 4-inch telescope into space, that's bordering on soda can size, you know, 3.5 inches.
Right, and that's actually sort of been happening. There was a space telescope a few years ago that essentially broke, but its finder scope was still in use, and it was about that size. But the issue you run into is a 4-inch scope doesn't have a lot of light gathering power, and your light gathering power is strictly based on how big that mirror is. And you also don't have hugely wonderful resolution with only 4 inches. Only 10 centimeters or so. So you're still better off at that size to build on the ground. It's still cheaper to build on the ground, and you'll get better images with your larger mirror on the ground, unless you're trying to do the very specialized task of photometry on bright objects.
Right, or you're attempting to view wavelengths that may be blocked by the Earth's atmosphere.
Well, for that, you're still going to run into the problem that the detectors are far larger. So while we can get optical instruments that are smaller, we still haven't figured out how to get the radio smaller, because that has to do with what's the wavelength. Infrared, again, you're running into issues of the wavelengths are bigger. X-ray detectors are larger. Ultraviolet detectors are larger.
Now, right now, there are thousands of active satellites. There are hundreds of thousands of chunks of space debris of varying sizes, larger than a centimeter. If we're going to be allowing more and more people to put up these little tiny satellites, is this going to add to the space debris problem?
Well, most of these have a very finite lifespan. They're being put into low Earth orbit, so you have the atmospheric drag is pulling them down and down and down and down. And when you're the size of a soda can, you don't have any rockets to keep you boosted into your orbit over time. So you're looking at things that are maybe going to last a year at most and then happily deorbit themselves. So what we're going to see is more and more shooting stars that aren't bits of dust. They're actually dead satellites.
So let's kind of imagine the future, though, right? Because, I mean, now that all of this technology, I mean, obviously, a mirror is a mirror is a mirror, and you can't miniaturize the mirror because then it just becomes a worse light-gathering tool. So you definitely want the largest possible mirror that you can get into space. But everything else is now gotten onto the computer curve, where over time, the price of these, the miniaturization is happening, the price of these things are coming down. You can imagine, and match that with SpaceX's goals to lower the cost of space launches by a factor of 10 over the next 10 years or whatever. What do you see then? I mean, what do you see in the future, right? Imagine launches are a tenth the price, the miniaturization has been going nonstop for another 10 years. What's going to be possible?
At that point, I think it's going to start to be the equivalent of companies like iTelescope are starting to reach out on orbit and put smaller telescopes on orbit. It's hard to say what time scale that's going to take place on, but organizations like the Folks Telescope, which is also the Las Campanas Telescope Network that Google's put together, these are educational facilities that have already invested surface side millions of dollars into staffing costs, infrastructure costs, to put networks of telescopes across the surface of the planet for schools to use, for private companies to rent time on, and individuals to rent time on. As we move forward, I can see Google, I can see individuals investing in creating not necessarily networks, but first one and then multiple smaller size telescopes on orbit. It's going to be a long time before it's individuals who aren't simply super wealthy who are considering doing this, but it's already reaching the point where universities are looking at projects that they can test in space. It's a complicated issue simply because there is that argument of, are you better off spending your money on a very large mirror on the surface of the planet or launching into space? And if you're launching, are you better off preparing something that goes up and comes back down on a sounding rocket, or are you better investing in something that will stay up much longer? And this is one of those times where I can forecast something and I'm no more likely to be right than the fortune-telling machine at the carnival. It's technology innovating, and it's very hard to predict how those innovations will take place.
Well, but I think you mentioned something that I think is very important, which is that universities will start to get access to be able to use some of their funding. And there's a ton of aerospace students who've never, and roboticists and computer technologists who've never had a chance to actually be involved in a launch of a mission from beginning to end. And what better practice in preparation for a career down the road, being in the aerospace industry or being in the satellite industry, than as part of your graduate product, you know, your master's degree, whatever, you designed, built, launched, and maintain a satellite.
And what was cool is when I was researching for this episode, I found two different student groups who'd basically done just that. There was the KickSat project that was put forward by Zach Manchester, a graduate student at Cornell University. And then there was the student-run Space Concordia project. Again, both of these projects were funded through Kickstarter. And these are ways that students are finding to put their ideas on orbit. And one thing that I think is neat to point out is all of these successful projects so far have all been on Kickstarter, which is a platform that when you put your idea up, it's either funded or not. People's money doesn't get spent unless the complete needed funding for a project is reached. Indiegogo, which is the main competitor for Kickstarter, has an option that allows you to put your idea up, and whatever amount of money you get, no matter how big or small it is, you get to keep that. And I've seen some bigger commercial ideas go up on Indiegogo that fell flat, did not get near the funding they needed. And I really appreciate the fact that all these successful ones so far have consistently been on Kickstarter, where they're saying, look, it's make it or not, trust us, and they've hit their target. There's been a lot of fails on Kickstarter, but the successes have all been there. The first exception might be Mars One. Mars One is currently running an Indiegogo campaign to try and raise $400,000 towards their first Mars lander and satellite. They have 20 days to go, and they're about 25% of the way to their goal. It's interesting to see how the bigger companies are using the crowdsourcing, not just as a fundraising mechanism, but also as an advertising mechanism that raises money for them. That's kind of a new business model that I find intriguing.
Yeah, well, personally, I invest in everyone that comes my way. I invest in all the Kickstarters that have anything to do with space exploration, telescopes, amateur satellites, any of them that I can get my hands on. And then we promote them like crazy on Universe Today. I'm really happy to help out anyone who wants to get the word out about the Kickstarter they're doing. I'm a huge fan of this kind of thing. Whatever we can do to kickstart this future industry, I love it.
It's going to be interesting to see just what happens in the next 2 years. I don't think it's 2 years away. I think it is already started. We've already seen launches. And I think these next 2 years are really going to define how Moore's Law applies to, space exploration.
And we will see how good of a fortune teller you are. Awesome. All right, well, thanks, Pamela.
Thank you. Okay, saving the episode. And muting to sniffle.
Cough. I really tried to hold off the coughing, but okay. Okay.
So we'll be back to answer your questions in just a second.
Yeah, we just have to make sure these get safely onto the server. So go ahead and if you've got any questions you want to do, put them into the questions, the Q&A app, or tweet at Pamela with the hashtag AstronomyCast, or make a comment on Google+ or on YouTube, and I will gather every single one up that I can and fire them all at Pamela.
So Martin, who's Red52013 on Twitter, has already asked, what about combining several small space launch telescopes and fly them together, keep adding to them as we do on Earth? So the problem with this is the CANSATs don't have propulsion systems. So they're not steerable or anything like that. We also don't have the ability to fly these things in tight formation. That requires a lot of lasers, a lot of sensors, a lot of weight, a lot of cost. And so far, not even NASA's been able to afford that.
But is there any value to having these, like, them come together in that way? Like, I can't see any, like, what would be the value of having these space telescopes all connect together as like some big pod, like maybe getting interferometry or something.
So you could do it with interferometry, except again we don't have the ability to fly in formation at a reasonable cost. You could, if you designed it right, actually build a multi-mirror telescope, but again we don't have low cost, low weight things like mirror edge sensors, and again don't have propulsion systems. So you can imagine the jigsaw three-dimensional puzzle of a space telescope, except CANSATs don't have propulsion systems.
Yeah. I mean, if someone could build an interferometer in space, that would just be swell. But yeah, who knows? I mean, the funny thing about this is just that up until now, all of the launches, all of the missions have run through this creaking government bureaucracy, you know, slow process. I mean, you're in the middle. You've done tons of proposals, and you know what it's like to get them rejected or approved, and the hoops that you have to jump through to get the whole
or
thing
or approved,
going.
And then your funding gets zeroed. That's the most painful one.
Or the telescope is cloudy. You know, it's cloudy on the night when you need to use the telescope, and you have to get rescheduled and blah blah.
There's an entire page in my dissertation. They don't reschedule you. You just don't get the data. I had an entire page in my dissertation dedicated to using data tables to complain about the weather because I had a statistically impossibly bad run of weather at McDonald Observatory.
Right. Yeah, so I mean, you can imagine, but we just like literally, we have no idea what the future is going to hold.
Yeah.
As collections of human beings come together on the internet to for a shared goal to raise money and throw it at both improving the technology and the kinds of missions that they find interesting. The ARCID was just your appetizer, and it's going to be amazing what's coming next. So I'm really excited.
One of the things I'm interested to see how it happens is I know there was a Russian, I want to say billionaire, who just like randomly emailed some top mathematicians and said, I want to fund you. And of course, everyone thought it was spammers initially. And no, it was actually this ultra-rich guy who reached out to some people to offer them huge amounts of funding. If we can get more ultra-rich people who are willing to give away significant portions of money, maybe not to them, but to the rest of us, to support launch costs, to support development, to support research. I think that we're moving back to the model of having science be something that is funded by the curious rich people and the royalty rather than funded by the governments.
Yep. Sterling Gothrop says, I've said it before and I'll say it again, the VSP needs its own space telescope. So that's the virtual star party that we did. So I think what we described, it would be cool to have a space telescope, but it would be better to have a real ground-based telescope that we could control that was robotic and was bigger, and that would be great. Although, he says that it could have the stupid moon block filter. And a flocculence enhancer. So that would be all right. Yeah. okay, so let's go. So Kelsey Kelsey Jewett says, how about requiring all launch satellites to have a deorbit package to get rid of it when it dies? So I think you kind of covered that most of them, they're in such low orbits, they're just all going to burn up anyway.
Yeah.
But I think there should be some kind of legislation or rules that if you're going to launch something into a longer orbit that is potential long-term space debris, you're going to have to deal with this.
And more satellites are being built with not necessarily deorbit systems, but systems that boost them up into parking orbits to get them out of the way of stuff.
Yeah, there's a really interesting strategy for removing space debris, where they would essentially use electromagnetism. So you would essentially, the satellite would be out in space and it would be charged one way, and then you would bring up your satellite and then you would charge it the opposite way, so they would be attracted, and then you would be able to then move the satellite over time from its current location to a parking location or whatever. I thought it was really fascinating. You know, to try and actually go and grapple them and grab them and stuff is actually pretty dangerous. So if you can, you know, even use a gravity tug, you know, where you bring your weight like really close to the object and then just slowly accelerate it away without actually needing to reach it.
But the problem comes in figuring out how to selectively grab things using electromagnetism. You're dealing with a force that carries out over a long distance. Same with gravity tugs. Those can both be very dangerous ways to grab things. There have been a whole bunch of really nifty ideas, though, for going out and grabbing things with what often look like daddy long leg satellites and using propulsion systems. One of the Scandinavian nations has been using them, has been looking into using them. NASA's looking into developing them. And so I think while there's always the potential to have your daddy long leg satellites die horrible deaths, there's dangers to all these systems. So it starts to become which is the safest, lowest weight. Electromagnetism is going to be high weight.
Yeah.
Way to do it.
Let's see. So we got Judy Rooks Wilder asks, who keeps up with how many spacecraft are launched?
NORAD.
Well, NORAD for sure, yeah, no, but I'm thinking like Heavens Above is a great website for keeping track of all the satellites that are up there, and they do a pretty good job of letting you know when the trajectories and when you can see them and stuff, so I recommend Heavens Above.
There's a lot of ham radio operators who know more than the government wishes they knew because they use them to bounce radio signals off of, and they're just out there yakking back and forth while observing satellites.
Friedrich Odling asks, is there any reason why launches are made at sea level? Wouldn't it require less fuel to launch at, for example, 1,000 meters? So wouldn't it make more sense to stick your launch facility at the top of a mountain and launch from there?
Well, so you're looking at two different facets. One, you want to be as close to an equatorial region as you can get so that you can use the Earth's rotational velocity to help you. And the other factor that you want to deal with is you want whatever's downrange from launch to not be very populated. And when you're trying to find a place that you can have the warehouses, you can have the construction buildings, you can have everything that you have that's associated with a launch facility, you're not going to find that at the top of a mountain. Now, they are looking at higher altitude sites when you look out at the Mojave Desert, when you look out in New Mexico where they're building Spaceport America. Here you have deserts downrange instead of oceans like Kennedy. But mountaintops just, they don't have the right geometry to build all of the facilities you need for assembling the rockets.
Yeah, I mean, you can imagine the winding roads that you have to get up to the top of the observatories. They're suicidal. But
yeah.
I think what's also really important is, as you said, that it's not about going up. It's about going sideways, right?
Yeah.
When you're launching a spacecraft, satellite, what's most important is that you get going 25,000 kilometers per hour sideways. Right? Because that's what gets you into orbit.
Yeah.
And so if you're like 1,000 feet up, you're going to have thinner air to go through. That'll be helpful, I guess. But apart from that, you get up above that air and then the rocket just flips onto its side. Play the Kerbal Space Program. You will you'll deeply understand this whole process.
And you also have to consider, what are the costs of getting up the mountain? It's not just suicidal, but it's expensive. So lots
yeah,
of
yeah, no, the best place on Earth, right, is the sea launch platform, which goes down to and just sits right at the very equator. Because when you're at the equator, then you get an extra 1,000 kilometers per hour of orbital velocity.
And this is where French New Guinea is such a good launch facility.
Yeah, and so the perfect launch facility would be right on the equator, on the shore. That is the direction they're going to want to launch the satellite. So as the rockets go up, they just go over the ocean, and if there's a problem, no problem, and you want good transportation to and from it. So
right,
top
barges
of a mountain,
work.
Yeah, top of a mountain really isn't that important. Earl McGuire asks, is China going to surpass the U.S. space program?
Yes.
Yes. Next question. No, I guess we should give some more detail. Maybe, probably, if things continue on the path they're at right now. The Chinese have just put a rover onto the surface of the moon. They have built a space station and have docked to it. They have launched multiple times, sending multiple people for long durations. At some point, they're going to send human beings to the moon.
Yeah.
This is absolutely inevitable. And, you know, it's going to happen within a decade?
I'd say it'll probably happen by 2020.
Yeah.
So the one thing that I've heard tell is one of the leaders, I can't remember his name right now, of the Chinese space program. I heard him give a talk at the International Space University program a few summers ago, and he said that they won't be able to get launch costs down as cheap as SpaceX. But in terms of being a national space program as compared to NASA being a national space program, they have an entire space industry. They have a better educational system than we have. They don't foster creativity the way we do in a lot of the Western nations. But in terms of just churning out people who are top minds in engineering, mathematics, they have such a huge population that statistically they're going to have more geniuses than we are in smaller population nations. And their education system is designed to find them and nurture them, unlike a mathematical genius who makes the mistake of being born in rural America where he's just going to get made fun of and called a nerd.
That sounds like maybe someone's childhood. But... but I think maybe mine. Right. But I think part of it as well is that you've got a horrible bureaucratic dictatorship, and that's a terrible downside, right? The fact that you really don't have a proper political system in China. The upside is if you want to launch people to the moon, you just make it happen through sheer force of will, right?
Right.
Like, how much does it cost? Who cares what it costs? Get those people on the moon. So,
which was our philosophy with Apollo.
Now, who knows? I mean, I think it might not be a sustainable program. And just like the Americans, they may get to a point where they put people on the moon and then they just go, why are we doing this? Forget it. This is dumb. So,
but I think when they get there, they're going to get there at the same time that the commercial space agencies are like, okay, you figured it out. We're going to take over now. And one of the things that China's been so good at is figuring out how to take on tasks for commercial companies and make them cost less.
Oh, this is a good question.
Oh no.
So Jens Riggelsen, one of our good friends, he's in Denmark, one of the moderators of the Space Committee on Google+, and he asks, what is the craziest theory you've ever been confronted with?
Oh, you mean like crank theory? There was, when I was at an American Astronomical Society meeting a few years ago, I had someone come in who was wearing a name badge that implied that he like had some named fellowship, and he had all the right vocabulary, and he was claiming to have found a problem with relativity, and he was using all the right words, he had all the right education, he had pedigree from a major university. And it was one of these things where I couldn't figure out if he was a crank or if he'd actually found a flaw in relativity. And he was name-dropping different people that he talked to, and so I did two things. One, I broke a graduate student and said, "Dear graduate student, can you please sit and chat with this fellow and find out some more about various different things?" And then I went off and I checked one of his references and was like, no. That was looked at in the 1950s, no. And so I think that was just in terms of being the most memorable. It's like, wow, even PhDs can be cranks. But in terms of the silliest I ever heard was, again, an American Astronomical Society meeting. Someone stood up in the planetary formation session, and the last talk of the session, which was as the room was filling up with people to come hear an awards talk, there is someone talking about how neutron stars evolve into planets basically, there were modified terms to both angular momentum and energy, and the justification he used was, if you cut the continents off of a normal-sized globe, you could glue them together into a continuous crust on the surface of a Nerf ball. And yeah,
about the gravity? Anyway.
Yeah, it was fun to watch everyone in the audience like, ooh, I want to take this guy out.
That's kind of awesome. I think the one that I've been sort of dealing with recently is people who are geocentrists, and they're absolutely convinced that the Earth is the center of the universe, that the Earth is flat, that the stars and the planets and the sun are all holograms projected around the Earth, and that all of the space launches are part of a conspiracy, and that none of this is really happening, and so on and so forth, right? And I mean, I don't even feel like having that conversation. So, you know, and we dealt with this a lot on the forum, right, which is where you get these people who have some theory, and they come and they really are telemarketers.
Sincere.
No, I don't know if they're sincere.
I've had some sincere ones emailing me after they got banned. They honestly believe what they're saying.
Sure. No, they may be sincere, but they're still getting banned because they believe that the way that you communicate your theory is by yelling.
Yeah.
Right? That you yell and you're mean to people. And you try to be the loudest voice as the way to have people believe what you're saying. And that's not the way science works. And
Or the way they deal with questions is to simply say the same thing over and over again. And that's not how science works. It's you say one thing, I poke at it with a stick, and you have to give me more details. Yeah, it's complicated, and I always, my first response to a lot of these people is, go take these following university courses.
Yeah.
Then come back.
Right, so as soon as you deeply understand relativity, then feel free to come up with a theory that's better than relativity.
Right, exactly.
Okay, so David Krasinski asks, I've been wanting your views on Mars One, which claims they will have a colony on Mars by 2023, and that somehow the billions they need will materialize from advertisers and investors. What do you think the likelihood is that they will pull this off?
I don't know.
Hmm.
This is one of these things where I don't have first of all, let me preempt this by saying I suck as a capitalist. I have no feeling for anything that has to do with money.
So this one's in my camp, right?
Right. So I think that they have plenty of people who have no money, which is the vast majority of the population, who want to see this work, want to see basically the next Massachusetts Bay Colony be Mars One, the one-way journey to set up a colony in the new world. But I don't know if they'll get the money, so I'm going to leave the money aspect to you.
Right. Well, when you think about the kind of money that gets spent in the United States and worldwide on various entertainment, I mean, what is it? Takeout pizza.
Yeah.
Is $50 billion a year. I mean, there is a lot of money that gets spent on a lot of things, and people are right now willing to invest in all kinds of stuff.
But I look at the ones that have failed. I mean, there was Golden Spike that was a spectacular fail. on Indiegogo, they raised less than $20,000, mm-hmm. and they were just trying to go to the moon.
And but these people they've got 50,000 applicants. They've chosen 1,000 applicants in the last little while. I think that there would be some level of interest in watching what happens, like being able to sell in the advertising. And I think when you look at the budgets for movies, for video games, I mean, Grand Theft Auto 5 cost $700 million to make, and it earned more than $1 billion in the first couple of months. So there is a lot of money on planet Earth, and if you can get that money focused into certain things, it is possible. So I would definitely not rule this out. And I think what's more important is the enthusiasm that people are demonstrating for this idea and for space flight in general. This may not be the one that gets pulled off, but people really want this kind of thing to happen.
And I think my pessimism comes from my own day-to-day dealing with fundraising, because with CosmoQuest, our bills are $300,000 a year, and we can only fundraise about a tenth of that. So, yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, so I think that's... So I can totally see from your perspective. But I feel like this one is probably not... Because it's going to be backed by enthusiasm of the crowd of people, as various events happen, as there maybe are failures, as people move on to something else, as the concentration wanes, the enthusiasm, you know, maybe it's going to be difficult for them to keep going. But the one that I think is going to work is Elon Musk's plans with SpaceX. And his plans are very aligned with what they want to do, which is that the whole reason he created SpaceX was to send humans to Mars.
What Mars One is currently missing is the billionaire who had the potential to be Batman or the Arrow. Elon Musk is neither of those things, but he has the money to do it. And he has the engineering desire to be Batman.
Yeah, and so I think his strategy is the right one, which is what he says is, first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to make the rocket capable of sending humans to Mars. Then I'm going to make it so profitable that it's making enough money that it could send humans to Mars. Then all the fundamental... Then we're going to figure out all of the technical unknowns. Then we will send humans to Mars. That, I believe...
Tony Stark. Elon Musk and Tony Stark are almost the same person.
Well, he was in... You know, Elon Musk was in Iron Man.
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah, he was. He had a cameo in Iron Man.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
How did I miss that?
I don't know.
Okay.
Your attention deficit disorder?
So,
yeah, no, I think that's the path. And so I can imagine them 3 years, 5 years down the road, starting to struggle, but they've got a huge crowd of people, they've got a lot of enthusiasm, and then Elon Musk comes along and just goes, I'll take all that. And I will put it together with what I've got rolling. And so they may not do it by 2023, but maybe Elon Musk will have it done by 2030. This is going to happen. Now, I think the bigger question is, should this happen? Should there be a one-way trip to Mars? Are we ready to live on Mars?
So when you ask that, I also look at the fact that there's the Jamestown colony that was placed somewhere that was a swamp, malaria-filled, not the right place, and everyone died, but not because of placement. They put the Massachusetts Bay Colony someplace that gets, like, 3 feet of snow at a time with nor'easters. Then there's the whole thing of Australia, which, again, not the most habitable of places on the planet.
Yeah.
Humans keep figuring out how to do it. And while Mars is way, way harder to survive on, we now have hydroponics. And here I have to give kudos to the marijuana industry, because they've been figuring out how to grow plants successfully in basements with no sunlight for decades. And what they've mastered is the exact same skills that the Mars colonists are going to need.
Yeah. So I would not, like, personally, I would not volunteer for a one-way trip to Mars. I'm all for space exploration, and I believe wholeheartedly that humans should go to Mars, but I am not ready to essentially starve and suffocate on the surface of Mars. So, but more power to them if that's what they're going to do. I just think there's tons and tons of intermediate steps that need to happen. If I was running the space industry, you know, it would be just a different strategy. So, okay, we're 108 now. How long have you got?
I'm doing okay, other than the whole sniffling, eye running, allergy attack thing. So as long as our audience is good with the sniffling, eye run, I'm fine.
Okay. All right, here we go. Thomas Tranicker asks, when New Horizons gets to Pluto, how long until we can see the images? So we actually covered this in the Space Hangout, Emily Lakawala.
A couple hours?
Well, no. They're going to be a few months before the encounter. The images from New Horizons are going to be better than the Hubble Space Telescope.
Right. But the time between the data leaving the mission and getting to Earth, I think that's a couple of hours.
Yeah, it's a couple of light hours away.
Yeah.
Christine Grosvenor asks, is it true that science has no explanation as to why objects with matter generate gravitational fields?
No, we get that. It's the Higgs boson.
Yeah, and the distortion of space-time as predicted by Einstein.
Mm-hmm.
Why does matter distort space-time? Because of the Higgs boson. Why does the Higgs boson exist? Like, at a certain point, you do kind of get to, I don't know. Right? Are there gravitons, you know?
Yeah.
Dylan Kombalak asks, is there any way to get matter out of a neutron star, maybe by hitting it real hard?
When it explodes as a supernova. If you dump matter onto it through accretion until it explodes, yes.
Yeah, I mean, it is theoretically possible to get matter off of a neutron star. It is practically impossible because the gravity is outrageous, but if you had a spaceship...
Exploding it works.
Smash two of them together, you'll probably get something out.
Yeah.
But once you hit black hole, nothing. There is no way
you
to get anything
else. You can't explode a black hole.
Yeah. Crash a black hole into another black hole, just a more massive black hole. Joseph Powell asks, how much better, relatively speaking, will the James Webb telescope image distant objects than Hubble?
Different. Apple versus orange. So Hubble, while it can see in some wavelengths of the infrared, it is primarily an optical telescope. The James Webb Space Telescope does not see in the optical. It is strictly an infrared telescope. It has a little more than 8 times the surface area, which means it will be able to see things that have 1/64th the flux, if I'm doing math in my head correctly, and many orders of magnitude fainter. So it's going to see things fainter than we've ever imagined.
Yeah, it's going to be so much better than Hubble Space Telescope. Like
in the infrared.
In the infrared, which the Hubble Space Telescope doesn't do very well at all. But it's going to be able to see like pretty much right to the earliest star formation, right to the edge of the observable universe, and see those first galaxies coming together.
Yeah, and for many purposes, the very large telescopes are able to do the same science as the Hubble Space Telescope. And in some cases, they can get higher resolution for some tasks because they are that much bigger and they have adaptive optics and they're at a great site. And they can use interferometry between the telescopes.
Sean Kennedy asks, how is it that if we're going to collide with the Andromeda Galaxy, if the universe is expanding? So
the expansion only applies to things that aren't held together through gravitational or chemical forces or strong and weak force. We're held together with Andromeda via gravity, so we are, it's like the individual raisins in raisin dough don't expand. It's the yeast producing gas that pushes those molecules apart. We're like a raisin. We're going to stay the same size no matter how big the universe around us gets.
Yeah, so on the short scale, things are able to overpower that expansive force in the universe. On the larger scale, I mean, we've had this conversation before, that there's probably some place where there are two galaxies that are being attracted to each other, and at the same time, space is expanding in between them, and that if you could measure the distance, they would just be perfectly
And I've seen talks on things where they've watched galaxies that are pretty much at that hub. And so the question is it's so the thing that what you're talking about doesn't take into account is the individual velocities. And so you have to take into account gravity and expansion to figure out if something's velocity will cause it to fall into orbit or travel on past.
Let's see.
So Pluto is 12 to 13 light hours away. I just got the tweet from Citizen Gold, and I confirmed it via Google.
Thanks, Google.
And Gold. Thanks, Gold.
So Dylan also asked, I want to know, how long would it take Venus to cool off if we could shade it from the sun completely? Like a solar shade.
No idea.
No idea.
And one of the reasons I have no idea is the amount of time it'll take to cool off depends on its internal composition and how much radioactive material it has inside of it. And
it depends what you mean by cool off, right?
Well, radiate its space, it radiate away its energy into space and go into thermal equilibrium with its
Yeah, but I mean, if you disappeared the sun tomorrow, Earth would be warm enough inside for billions of years. I mean, it would last would last a long time because of this radioactive elements in the core that are continuing to radiate this heat
out
for a long time.
The surface would freeze fairly quickly.
Almost instantly, yeah. Josh W. asks, what is the explanation for Venus's slow retrograde rotation?
I don't really have a good one. Various ones that have been put forward include everything from it's been torqued through resonating with Earth, it's been hit, long-term dynamical effects of just its orbit. It gets affected by us. That's basically it.
Well, the thing is that Venus is rotating backwards compared to all of the other planets in the solar system, and it's going very slowly. And so I was listening to an interview with Neil deGrasse Tyson, that you could walk along the surface of Venus at normal walking pace and make the sun rise in the wrong direction. Because the speed that it rotates is so slow, you can do it with walking speed.
Yeah,
which I'll bet you is what Josh is referencing. He heard the Radiolab interview with Grass Tyson. Sterling Gothrop asks, do space telescopes like Hubble have air between the lenses and mirror, or do they vent the air somehow and have a vacuum inside?
They're vacuum inside.
Yeah, air
That's why you see a lot of the delays between when they launch a space telescope and when they get first light is they're letting everything space harden and vent and come into thermal equilibrium and all that sort of stuff.
I think we're good. I think we have
Wow.
wrapped up the questions. Let's see if I can see any more. Tom Nathie says the hollow Earth or inverted universe stuff is hilarious. Agreed. Tom Nathie also suggests using a solar sail for deorbiting. Which we've talked about that a bit, that even, I mean, when they plan out missions, they have to use the solar sail effect, they have to take that into consideration. And so theoretically, you could have some spacecraft that, you know, tilts itself with its little solar sail to deorbit itself very slowly.
And I'm getting a correction. Apparently the site that I verified the distance to the Pluto in light hours with lied, like a insert naughty word. And according to Wolfram Alpha, which is a much more reputable source, apparently, than this one that I thought was reputable that I use all the time, which is not Wikipedia, which is why I'm not naming it. According to Wolfram Alpha, its current distance to Pluto is 4.7 light hours, and the average distance is 5.7 light hours.
Wolfram Alpha is voodoo black magic. It's one of my favorite tools. I love that website.
You can't use any of the results for commercial purposes or research purposes without citing them.
Well, I just use it for math.
Okay.
I make calculations with it, but crazy calculations, right? Like, I may ask things like, what is the you know, 40 miles per hour in light years per century and things like that. You know, and it's
right,
no problem.
Right.
Happy to calculate, right? So, yeah, I know it's pretty funny. Cool. Okay. Well, why don't we wrap this up then? So, as always, Pamela, thank you for providing the brain. We really appreciate that. And we're
Please
done
send
our series.
Us warm temperatures.
Yeah, from Canada. So we're done with this. I don't even know what our next topic is. We've got it planned out somewhere. So
yeah. We will have an episode next week. We do not know what it will be on.
Yes. It's been planned. I've even written my intro. I just don't know what it is. Yeah, so we'll be doing that next week. So same bat time, same bat channel. We'll be doing the weekly space hangout on Friday. And if you have a chance, by all means, go back and check out last night's virtual star party. It was epic. We had 6 telescopes, 2 pointed at the sun, 1 at the moon. We had live views of Jupiter. We had Venus during the day. We had all color shots of deep space objects. It was just terrific. Best star party we've ever had.
There will be a ton of astronomy news this week because it's the American Astronomical Society meeting. And so all astronomers that might possibly have had something of any interest held it off until this week, and now we get all the news.
Sweet. We're all hands on deck at Universe today, that's for sure. So awesome. Okay, well, thanks everyone for watching. Pamela, thanks for joining me, and we will see you all next week.
Sounds good.